Good morning, RBC. How do you all feel? Awesome. Yeah, how you all feel? Fantastic. Christmas is coming, right? Can you all feel the spirit is coming? Eating more, gaining more weight. I definitely, you see, I cannot see my neck anymore. My neck and this shirt, I think everything is getting bigger. So happy to be chairman again this month and to see everybody here. Okay, let's bow our heads and just pray. Okay, and just thank God for everything they've done for us. Dear Father, we just want to thank you for the safe journey to church. We pray that God, that you continue to keep Singapore safe, keep everybody safe, our family and friends from the new variant. We also pray that God, we can use this time to meet people and just to show our care and love for them, right? It's never easy during an endemic. So we pray that God, that you will just help us to, you know, send a message to them that you love them and that you always take care of them. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Yeah, super excited to come back. I just started my work this week, my new job this week. Yeah, so one thing that I wanted to share was before I left my company, I keep telling everyone that I was really in the best job ever. Okay, I felt that I was really in the best job and I didn't feel a need to change. Okay, so I felt comfortable. Joel can attest to that. So, you know, like, so I felt like, you know, this is gonna be, I can just stay in this job forever. Okay? But then when I changed to my new job, what I didn't realize is that for the past 2 years, because I've been working in a US time zone, so what happened is that I actually sleep. I work from 10 p.m. to 4 or 5 a.m. in a weekday. And then on a weekend, I actually have to swap back to local Singapore time. So I'm like jet lagging most of the time. So that made me very lethargic in the mornings. So I can't come to church because I need to sleep. And my kids, you know, they obviously wake up when the sun rises, right, around 7 a.m. Their body clock is auto-tuned, so they'll wake me up on the weekends. So I get very tired. So what I did not realize is that actually my previous job caused me to take away time from church or from my family and friends. But now I just starting to change to Singapore time, I realize there's a big difference. Okay, why I want to share this with you? Because I think ultimately God knows what's best for you. Well, sometimes you think like, you know, you got it all like settled and done, right? So that's why I want to share this with you, because, you know, sometimes God can see things better and clearer for you, right? You may not understand, hey, why is he doing this to you, you know? Should you make this kind of change, right? So when I was changing my job, I asked a lot of my close friends, hey, should I do it or not? And this is my best job. Should I change or not? That kind of thing. So when you feel something is really in the best position and you're comfortable, you won't want to change, right? Doesn't make sense, right? But I prayed, and then he said, no, you have to change. So now only it's in the first week, but I understand, oh, you know, because of that, then I gain so much more back. So that's why then I can be chairman again and things like that. So I'm really happy. I just want to share this with you because I think this is what I learned, okay? So trust in him and, you know, make sure that sometimes, you know, don't lean on your own understanding. I think Uncle Swimming shared that last week. Of course, I cannot quote you, I'm not so pro. But basically, in short, you know, sometimes once you know, you think you know, right, then you start to do things in your own way. Yeah, so just wanted to reflect back that you need to lean on him fully, 100%. Not even 99%. The data must transfer 100%, right? Then upload. You know, after you download, you must update and upload, okay? So, yeah, thank you, Uncle Swimming, for the message last week. Okay, so, okay, let's rise for worship. Just want to share something that I learned. Being with God and being a Christian is a journey and a relationship. So that's why all these stories help one another. I'm not sure where you are in your life, but hopefully this will give you some, you know, encouragement. Okay, let's start our worship.
Thank you. their songs employ. While fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy.
Good morning, everyone. We rejoice that we can come together again as the body of Christ and to celebrate the Lord's Supper today. Could I invite all of us just to bow down for the word and ask the Holy Spirit to search our heart and prepare our heart for this sacred moment. If there's any sins that we commit against God, shall we just humbly come before Him and confess them. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, we acknowledge that as we come here for the Lord's Supper, this is a holy ground, and we ask that, Lord, you search our heart. May you forgive us our sins, consciously and unconsciously, that commit against you. God, have mercy upon us. We thank you that by the blood of Jesus Christ, you cleanse our sins, and we are able to approach you. We thank you, Father, for this wonderful grace. God, we like to pray that you will help us to humbly come before you. Help us with the right posture to fear you, to reverence you. Thank you. Christ's most precious name we pray. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Dear brothers and sisters, I'd like to invite all of you to stand up. The Lord's Supper is for those who are baptized in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and together we can partake the Lord's Supper as one body of Christ. Shall we now partake it together? Let's pray. God, we like to thank you. We thank you that we can partake the Lord's Supper. We thank you for this freedom in this country. The Lord, we like to pray that as we come before you, we want to declare that Christ has come. Christ has died. He has buried, and he has resurrected. He has ascended into heaven. And Lord, we are looking forward for his second coming. So Lord, while we are waiting upon his second coming, we pray that you will empower us to live a life that is pleasing to you, a life that is glorifying you. And Lord, we ask that you will empower us so that we, as we move forward, we can be the salt and light for your kingdom's sake. We praise you. We thank you. Christ's most precious name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Okay, today's message is Christmas 1, all right? So it's going to be a sequence. So Christ is the reason for the season, all right? And the reference Bible verse is Luke chapter 2, verse 8 to 14, okay? So let's read this together. 1, 2, 3. "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." Amen. I'd like to invite Pastor Yap to lead the message.
Thank you, Jimmy. This month is today is the beginning of December, and we are going to celebrate Christmas. But do you know that there is people on earth that celebrate Christmas even much earlier? Thanksgiving? Which country do you think that they will celebrate Christmas much, much earlier? A very good question, answer. Now, you may be surprised that the Filipino celebrates Christmas way back. And one of my Filipino friends told me that they celebrate Christmas since when? Since September. Since September. And we really go and search for Google, and it reflects that the Filipino really stops celebrating Christmas since September. And he gave me a trick how to remember it. Any month that ends with B-E-R, that's it. September, October, November, December. Okay? So, wow. No wonder Filipinos are filled with joy, right? They're always very happy all around. Yeah, Christmas is a season of joy, right? Even in the midst of this difficult and challenging time, as I always mention, you know, God never changed, his message never changed, and his message is always full of hope and full of joy. So this morning, I'd like to just bring ourselves back to ask one very question. Why do we celebrate Christmas? The answer is? The answer is what? Because of Christ, right? Christ is the reason for this season, right? But more than that, you know, when you ask, okay, for those people, in the world, they will say that, oh, Christmas is a time of celebrations, okay? For the ladies, Christmas is a time for shopping, okay? For the gentlemen, Christmas is a time that, you know, the pocket's hole is broken, right? But for us, what is Christmas? And when people really come to you and knowing that you are Christians and say, tell me, what the Bible tells about Christmas? What is actually Christmas? Okay, for those who are, you know, maybe our children, they will say, oh, Christmas is, you know, we always know that a baby, you know, baby in a manger, and there are kings that surround him, and Joseph and Mary was in the stable, right? And that is Christmas for the children. But how about us? When people ask you, what is Christmas about? You got the answer? Well, I want to just suggest that, you know, the Bible teaches us this very, very important concept, is this one word. Christmas is about the word incarnation. Okay? Repeat after me. Incarnation. And what is incarnation? Incarnation is when God come down into the earth in flesh. As a man, God become man. And this is the only time in the history of, say, time, history, or even in the time or time frame of eternity, that God come on earth as man. So much so that even Satan wants to deny that. Where do you get it? See? The Bible teaches us this, how to test whether the spirit is a false spirit. It says that, ask this question, do you acknowledge that Jesus Christ come in flesh? And it's so powerful, and it's so important that even as we talk about, dream about, or even say about Christmas, we must always know that the purpose of Christmas, why we celebrate Christmas, is because Jesus Christ come down on earth as man, okay, incarnation, right? The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the heaven, full of grace and truth, right? So the beginning of the, you know, the first phrase of John, the first chapter of John, he was mentioning that, you know, the Word become flesh. And this is a very, very important fact that we Christians embrace and acknowledge and know. And because of this, in fact, because that Jesus Christ has come down and the Word become flesh, it actually destroyed, overcome the world of Satan. And that is so much important, right? You see, the season of Christmas is actually a season of joy. And if you were to look through the book of Luke, there are many instances that tell us that in the book of Luke, portray the joy that we need to have, that we have for this good news. Right? When we talk about good news, it's the news of hope and it's the news of joy, and especially at this period of time, that when people in the world are lacking of this, what does the world lack of now? A lack of hope and a lack of joy. And in the way that, you know, when people look at Christians, they want to see that, you know, the Christian life can portray the joy in spite of all the circumstances, right? And this is the season. This is the season that we are telling our people around us that we indeed are people of joy. We are the people of hope, right? And let me just go through some of the verses that the book of Luke portray, that Jesus taught us about God's joy and happiness, you know, when he received a sinner back into his friendship. The kind of coming home of a sinner is a feast for God. In this Luke chapter 15, verse 7, he says, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 respectable people who do not need to repent. That is found in the parable of the lost soul, Luke chapter 15, verse 7. Again, he says in Luke chapter 15, verse 10, he says, I tell you, the angel of God rejoices over one sinner who repents. Again, the son was still a long way from home. When the father saw him, his heart was filled with pity, and he ran and threw his arms around his son and kissed him, and he said, bring the best robe and put it on him, put a ring on his finger and shoe for his feet. Then go get the prize calf and kill it, and let us celebrate with a feast. That is found in the parable of the prodigal sons, Luke chapter 15, verses 20 to 23. And then also the reactions, okay, of Jesus' message, the good things that he brought is always one of the joy. Luke chapter 1, verse 14. How great and happy you will be, and how happy many others will be when he is born. Again, Luke chapter 2, verse 11, which we have read. I have good news for you, which will bring great joy to all the people. This very night, your Savior was born. The angels said to the shepherds. Again, in Luke chapter 10, verse 17, it says, the 72 disciples came back in great joy. Lord, they say, even the demons obey us. And Luke chapter 13, verse 17, all the people rejoice over every wonderful thing he did. So you can see in the book of Luke, the theme of joy is running through. And what is the book of Luke? It's a book of gospel. It's a book of great news. It's a book of good news. So brothers and sisters, each of us, every one of us, carry this message of good news. Right. This year, we are very happy that we are going to baptize three persons. Tony, Kelvin, and Jesslyn. And we rejoice with them. And I want to share that, you know, I believe that even in the day of baptisms, the angels in heaven will be rejoicing also. This is a message that God wants us to spread and wants us to enjoy, that we have the good news. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Even in this statement itself, it can actually blow your mind that how can a majestic God, that he is willing to come down on earth and box himself, or to say, to fix himself into a very limited shape for the purpose of redeeming us. Who are we? And yet, John was saying that when they look at Jesus, they know that this Jesus is full of glory, the glory of God, full of grace and truth. This was affirmed by the angels. You know, the Gabriel that said to Mary, she will give birth to a son and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sin. Right beginning of even before Jesus was born, his purpose is already established. Not only in the New Testament, you will be surprised, ever since in the Old Testament when Adam and Eve sinned against God. God already promised that Jesus is coming down to help us with the redemption. And this took place to fulfill what the Lord has said through the prophets. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they call him Emmanuel. Emmanuel. And what is Emmanuel? God with us. Okay. God with us. Adam and Bell has given the child, their child, Emmanuel. Very wonderful name. Whenever they look at this boy, they remind themselves, God is always with them, and God is always with us. The Almighty God became Emmanuel, God with us, so we can spend eternity with him. And with this thing, this great news, it will really blow our mind, you know, that sometimes we may feel to grasp it. I believe that even the shepherd on the field, they may not really fully understand what is happening, but they will be very amazed. They say, oh, angel, you know. And then, wow, I followed angel's words, and then say, oh, that's a baby. but they haven't really realized the significance that God has become man. God has become man, and God, the Word, has become flesh. Why? Because God has given us a place, a way to reach back to Him. And that is the good news, brothers and sisters. You know, sometimes when we are down, you know, we face difficulties, when we have things that doesn't work in our way, and then our spirits will begin to murmur, begin to complain and all this. May the Spirit of the Lord remind us that all these are temporal. That God put us on earth for a purpose. To proclaim the good news. And not only that, to enjoy God and to worship God. Christ is the reason for the season. Okay? Why do we celebrate Christmas? Not because, you know, we want to increase the sales of the, not Shopee, right? Population. Very popular one is Shopee, right? Lazada. It's not a time for us to increase the sales for that. It's because of Christ. I want you to draw back to the reason why Christ came on earth. Because there is a solution, a problem that needs a solution. Right? You say, wow, you know, if you want to talk about problems, everywhere also got problem. Huh? Everywhere, every time everyone will meet some problems. Okay? Starting from a problem, mathematical problems in your assignments to problems with your colleagues, problems with your work, and all everywhere is problem. Right. But that is a problem that the mankind cannot solve. We may solve a lot of problems with our advanced technology. But there is a problem throughout the history of mankind that cannot be solved. And this is a problem of sin. A sin. Okay, the original sins and the inherent sins and the sins that we commit against God every day. The problem of sins cannot be washed away, cannot be cleared, except by the blood of Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 3, verse 10 to 11, it says that as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one, there is none that understand, there is none that seek after God. You may say that, hey, this is not true, man. You know, at times when we, you know, we have problem, we will seek after God. Huh? When we have problem, we will come to Him, right? And that's why we seek after God. But it's not true. This is not true. Because by nature, our rebellious nature, we will never turn to God. Even if we seek God for our selfish motive. As it is written, there is none righteous. No one is righteous before God. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. And brothers and sisters, that is the reason. That is the reason why Christ has to come down. That all of us have sinned and we cannot reconcile to God. How many times that we really come down to before God and reflect about our lives and really come to the stage that God, you are really a holy God. Notice how I face it. Not because we are sinful. No. But basically, the reference is because God is holy. How many times that we want to say that, no, God, we want to worship you because you are truly holy. And brothers and sisters, whenever we really acknowledge that God is holy, it will be a reflection that how sinful are we? It's not that, you know, God, I commit this, I commit that, and that's why, you know, I feel very bad. No. It's because of the holiness of God that when he reflects his holiness, we begin to know that we are all guilty. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 reminds us that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And who can know it? And this heart is my heart and your heart. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12, it mentioned that there is a way which seems right unto a man, but the end, therefore, are the ways of death. The Bible itself keep on reminding us that we cannot be righteous by our own way. We cannot be righteous. And this is the biblical truth. Right? This is the biblical truth. That God is telling man, not of this generation, but of the past generation and the generation in future, that man cannot do good to gain salvation. That's the way we seem right unto a man, but the end are the ways of death. Brothers and sisters, many times that people come to me to ask for counseling, to seek for help. You know, they will just seek for a solution. You know, they say, Pastor, can you help me to get rid of this problem? But when we want to see the whole thing, the whole issue, is that they have to know that where he or she stand before God. The root of the whole matters is always, where are we in the sight of God? The thing that I always have a headache is that, you know, when people come to me, the couple comes to me and say, Pastor, you know, we want to seek for a divorce. And then they say, we already decide in 1 or 2 weeks' time. How do you expect a pastor to solve your problem? What I'm saying is that many times the consequence that we bear is because we refuse to turn to the Word of God. And the Word of God reminds us again, all of us is sinful before God, and there's none righteous before Him, and we need to come back to Him. The problem is not about divorce problem. The problem is not about lack of food. The problem is because of sin. The only solution is found in John in the Gospel. Say that, you know, Jesus answered and said unto them, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And brothers and sisters, I want to let you all know that ever since the Adam and Eve sin against God, and when Satan interferes, there are two kingdoms in the world. The kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness. The world, the people in the world may not recognize that, but as children of God, we always need to know that. Even now, we are living between this kingdom of God and we are facing the kingdom of darkness. Right? Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. John chapter 14, verse 6, it says, Jesus said unto him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto me but by me." I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man come unto me, unto the Father, but by me. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? God, Jesus Christ, is the only way. And if we were to believe that, we will always keep on sending the message that, you know, people will always say that hey, every religion leads to the same God. But we have to stick the fact that, no, Jesus Christ is the only way. Acts chapter 4, verse 4, 12, it says that neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven among given men whereby we must be saved. And this name is Jesus. Many times I always feel that, you know, we do not know the power of Jesus. We do not know the wonder of Jesus, the name Jesus. So much so that even the evil spirits know more than us. His name is wonderful. The name Jesus means Jehovah is salvation. And Jesus may have a common name, but he was no ordinary baby. His birth was normal, but his conception was anything but normal. Jesus was a real human body, but he was also God in the flesh. When Jesus was born in Bethlehem, God came to earth to live among men. So the implication is this: the Creator became dependent upon the creature. He named himself. And when we speak of the Jesus of the Bible, we are referring to God in the flesh. The name declares his intention. Okay? Jehovah is salvation. The word salvation tells us what Jesus came into the world to accomplish. He came to save his people from his sin. The word save means that keep safe and sound and to rescue from danger or destruction. All men are walking towards destruction. All men are walking into hell. But how could Jesus bring about this salvation? He tells us in his own words, Jesus came to this world for one purpose only, and that purpose was to die on the cross for sinners. And this is a very unique mission. Jesus is the only person that come to, you know, to be born to die. His purpose was to die on the cross for sinners. Even our Lord's great mission statements, Luke chapter 19, verse 10, reveal his intention. But in spite of all he did while he was here, his primary purpose in coming into this world was so that he could die for his people. And brothers and sisters, take a moment to think through that Jesus Christ can accomplish so many things. You know, he's so great, he can be the king at any time. You know, he can perform miracles. And yet, he knows his purpose. His purpose is to die at the cross for his people. Christ is our perfect substitute. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6, it reads, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquities of us all. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, it says, for he had made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, yet that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, for Christ also once suffered for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. Brothers and sisters, I know that you all are very familiar with all these verses. But I always take time to really process what it actually means. It means that a creator is willing to lay down his life to die for us. Because sin is so terrible. Sin is the things that separate us from God. Sin is the thing that cut the fellowship between God and man. And it is only through the blood of Jesus Christ, who is willing to die at the cross, that our sin can be cleansed. And when God looks at us through Jesus Christ, he can declare us as righteous. Christ is the perfect substitute. Not only that, the name Jesus is our Lord's human name, but he was all God, yet he was all man too. And this is the fantastic way. The Lord of glory came into this world. He came not as a king, but a humble servant. He was not born in the palace, but a mayor. Jesus understood poverty. He understands us. He feels tired. He experienced hunger. He experienced rejections. He experienced loneliness and temptation and the rise of the trials of the human condition. And yet, he overcame each of them. The Bible says that he is sinless. He's here to set an example for us to follow. Jesus Christ is fully human and fully divine. He endures all that he did so that he might identify himself with us. He understands us and be able to comfort us in our trials. Coming back to the story of the Christmas. What is Christmas? Christmas is the incarnation of God, that Jesus Christ is willing to come down in flesh and to experience what a man go through so that he understands us through and through. He is not a God who is very far distant, giving any instruction, but he is really in the midst of us. He dwells among us. He's walked through the journey of suffering. And he understands us. And yet, he overcomes all this. Do you love Jesus? Do you have a room for him? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And I give unto them eternal life, that they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. It's a promise. Wherefore, he is able to save them unto uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever lived to make intercessions for God. Is it good to be a Christian? Definitely. God so loved us that we are willing, you know, he gives us this eternal life when we believe Christ. Don't we hope that this wonderful gift can be accepted by our friends, relatives, and our beloved ones? And the fact is that, you know, this truth must driven us to even reach out for more people. What do we do for this season of Christmas? First of all, you know, we must always remember Christmas is incarnation of God, and thereby it's a season of joy, it's a season of hope, it's a season that we can share with the world. And we need to repent, therefore, and be comforted, and your sins may be poured out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Right? Brothers and sisters, friends, if we haven't come to the Lord for repentance, we have yet to experience the joy of salvation, especially those who have not accepted Christ. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. We got to put Christ into our Christmas. Let this Christmas be a unique one, that you experience Christ, Christ the incarnate one, in your life. Romans chapter 10, verse 9, it says that if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So when you trust in Christ to forgive your sins and give your eternal life, you will find the real meaning of Christmas. For those who have not known, for those who are watching over online, for our friends, if you have not given your life to Jesus Christ, you have not experienced the real meaning of Christmas. But why not make that choice now? If you will believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died on the cross for you, was buried, and rose again, you may want to pray this prayer with all your heart. This is a message for those who have not known Jesus Christ. It's a message for those that you carry to people, and when you lead people into this prayer. Brothers and sisters, you may have one or two names or three names in your mind that you want to spread this gospel to him, to her, in this season. Remember this prayer. And for those who heard and have not yet believed Jesus Christ, allow me to just pray this prayer together with you. Heavenly Father, I realize that I am a sinner and that I have done some bad things. I'm a sinful man. For Jesus Christ's sake, please forgive me of my sin. I now believe with all my heart that Jesus Christ died for me, was buried, and rose again. Lord Jesus Christ, please come into my heart and save my soul and change my life today. Amen. Take down this prayer. When you share the gospel to anyone at any time, and when you want to really to accept Christ, pray along with him or with her. What do we do as a Christians? I'd like to urge you that in this season, let us rededicate ourselves to Lord Jesus. Let us acknowledge that Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords again. Let us acknowledge that, Jesus Christ is our only Savior. Believe by faith, share the faith, and keep the faith. And together, let's share this good news to others. For Christ is the reason for the season. Amen. What do you bring back today? The real biblical meaning of Christmas. One word, incarnations. Brothers and sisters, I invite you to stand up. First of all, I want you all to just come back to God. And renew our relationship with him again. At the same time, ask God to help you to reach out to a few names that he can impress your heart upon, so that God, you can bring them, share the good news with them in this season. Last but not the least, May God help us to live a life of joy, to live a life of hope, and to manifest God's goodness in our life. In the midst of this pandemic time, Christ is always our hope. God, we like to thank you for this quiet moment. In the midst of our busyness, we have no room for Jesus. May you forgive us. Refresh us again, Father. We also pray that, Lord, we are able to even share this good news with our beloved ones. Through all means, may you open doors for them. May you give them the opportunity also. Soften their heart, and Holy Spirit convict of their sins, that they are willing to run towards Jesus Christ and to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Pray for our brothers and sisters here. Fill our hearts with joy, fill our hearts with hope, and fill our heart with your power. Thank you. Christ's most precious name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you, Pastor, for the message. Truly, truly, it's a season of Jesus Christ. I think the key thing I take away is that it's also a time for us Christians to, you know, reconnect with God, right? I'm sure a lot of us, before when we become believers, you know, we experience Christmas, or even as Christians, right, it's the best time, right? You really look forward to Christmas is because you feel the joy. And I think, like, that's why we must remember, you know, like what Pastor mentioned, right? We must always keep the faith and remember why was he born. And not forget, you know, the salvation that we have. The salvation that he has given us, the love that God has given us is really something truly amazing. So thank you, Pastor, for this message. And, you know, just making sure that we just keep focus also to the fact that, you know, Jesus came here, he was born, right? So, thank you, Pastor. Okay, let's all rise for the doxology.
Church, let's receive the benediction together. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
All right. Thank you, Pastor. Okay, so a couple of things. First and foremost, offering. Okay, so if you came in, I'm not sure whether you noticed, there's a QR code right here. All right, so very easy, scan, pay now, right? You can just transfer and then make the offering. Okay, I think the key thing is that, the main thing for me, I feel, for offering is that it's Christmas, right? So give, you know, in that spirit. And there are a lot of, I'm very sure, you know, the council and the mission department has many ways to help others. There's a lot of needs that's beyond Singapore. We are really, really very blessed. When we look at the rest of the countries, what they're doing, there's a really need, really basic need. So whatever tithings that you give or offering, right, it goes into those efforts as well. Okay? So I know that you'll probably do it later or whatnot, but let's pray for it. I just want to pray for it. Then, Father, thank you, God, for the blessing that you have given us. You know, regardless of whether it's monetary or not, thank you for everything we have received. Some things that, you know, we can't even see that you're working at the back. Thank you so much, God, for making those paths very smooth and, you know, very open to us. We just pray that, God, that all the offerings that's coming to RBC, you know, you continue to bless us so that we make the right choices, you know, choices that you want us to make so that we are, you know, blessing the right communities, we're doing the right things, you know. We just want to thank you, God, for everything you've provided for RBC. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Okay, so yeah, just go to QR code, scan it, or just do a bank transfer like me. So yeah, thank you so much. Okay, I'll go back to the announcement. Okay, kids' church. So, you know, like for me, I got three boys. So I'm fully maximizing the church child service. Very full, okay? You can see they are running anywhere. Huh? So, last time, you know, when I was young, right, there was a family friend who wanted to just bring me to church. So, even though, like, the parents wasn't Christian, but say, hey, free childcare, I'll take. No need to let, just tomorrow also can, no problem, just take. So, feel free, make full use of this facility. And I thank Joel, he's always pushing for it. In council, he say, when can you open kids' church? When can you open kids' church? So, really, really thank him so much as well. Oikos, if you don't have an Oikos, please join one, okay? A lot of stuff happens there, conversations and truths and learnings happen beyond just, you know, a church setting. So, just join an Oikos, you'll find that you'll meet amazing friends and it'll help you as well as a support group. Pastoral visitation. So if you want a pastor to come and visit you, you know, whether it's like to bless your family or something you're going through, please just feel free to reach out to him. Pastor is really great. Okay? So I think offerings-wise, this is just to show you the total amount. Okay, so far so good, but definitely the more the merrier, because we also need to do our pledges and things like that. So operating this church, you know, we need to thank God for everything that he has done for us thus far. Okay? Do come for our Oikos prayer service. It's on Zoom. Okay? So personally, I love the Zoom sessions. And, you know, even though it's online, but it is, I feel it's, you know, it's still there. You feel the Spirit of God coming to you. So do join. It's on the 10th of December. Mandarin service, so do come for Mandarin service. Great feedback. I heard a lot, you know, that, you know, the speakers there are fantastic. You know, sometimes you got some Chinese speaking friends, just bring them over. You don't come for the English one, just go for a Chinese one. Hey, it may change your mind, you know, right? Sometimes it's just like, it's refreshing just to change. Hey, let me go and check out the Chinese congregation. Wow, you know, it's happening, you know, it's different. Okay, so attendance up 100 per pax per session. Okay, so don't be shy. Not as limited, but still be safe. All right, make sure that you're maintaining the safe regulations and whatnot. Okay, so Christmas service, really, really exciting. Saw the agenda. It's packed filled. There's even a baptism that's happening. So it really shows, you know, the Christmas spirit. At the same time, people who are receiving Christ on Christmas, I know it's 26, but the spirit is there. It's amazing because it's not. We are basically showing people who are really believing in Christ and they walk through the walk and they want to be baptized. So it's an amazing worship service that is very different, right? So I want to thank the community for that. Okay. So monthly prayer focus. You know, pray for the salvation of for our pre-believer friends. Okay. Don't give up hope. I think the magic number is 3. So if you got 3 people, you just pray. One family, one friend, one colleague, huh? Each in one category. And whichever, you know, God impressed on your heart, right, just pray. And then make sure you tell your cell group leader or all course leader, say, hey, you know, I got this person I really been wanting to invite for donkey years, okay? But I want a breakthrough, you know, I want this time, this person to really come, you know? So, like I said, the service would be great. There will be a baptism, you know, there's even like, there's a concert as well. So a lot of things happening, a lot of effort. So just pray, you know, never know what happens. You just jolt this person, hey, come on, you know, anyway, it's on 26th, what? It's not on actual Christmas. You can come, right? So things like that. Okay, for a monthly memory verse, I think let's read this together, okay? Because this is to commit to our memory, okay? So let's just do this once, okay? 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 12. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. Amen. Okay, I think this is really the right verse. Christmas is the time of giving. Everyone's in that spirit. Okay, so commit this to your memory, all right? Okay, thank you, congregation, for the great time. So I just want to close the session. Okay, let's close our eyes and just pray. Dearly Father, thank you so much for, you know, the great message today and the fellowship that we have. I pray that, God, that the words that's being spoken, you know, will be present to our heart and that, you know, we can take it forward, you know, and just start to look at things differently in your light, O Lord. I pray that, God, that you will bless us for our Christmas service, you know, that people will come, right? They'll feel excited. They'll come together and then they'll be able to witness your glory, O Lord, and to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. We want to just thank you, God, for keeping us safe, and I just pray that, God, that, you know, we'll have a blessed week this week. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Okay, thank you, RBC. Right, come back. See you all next week. All right, and remember, join our course group if you don't have. Okay, thank you.